Well, good evening and welcome to worship this evening. As we prepare our hearts to worship God, let me read from Psalm 50. The Mighty One, God the Lord, speaks and summons the earth from the rising of the sun to its setting. Out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth. Our God comes. He does not keep silence. He calls to the heavens above and to the earth that he may judge his people. Gather to me, my faithful ones, who made a covenant with me by sacrifice. The heavens declare his righteousness, for God himself is judge. Our Lord God, we come to you this evening as your people. We come under your holy word. We come to you who are the judge of all. And though judgment is terrifying to the wicked, it is encouraging to your people that justice will be done for those who are wicked and for those who have been mistreated in the world. Justice will be done. You are the God who both judges and justifies the ungodly. And we come tonight delighting in the fact that through Christ, we now know ourselves to be justified by faith, to know that there is now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. And on the basis of those glorious facts, we come to praise your holy name and call on you to come and be present amongst us as your people. We pray this in Jesus' strong name. Amen.
Thank you. using our bulletins to confess our sins together. But before we do that, let's bow and confess our own sins to the Lord in silence for a moment. Let's confess together. O Lord, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, be the God of your people today. We confess that we have worshipped all too many other gods. We have devoted ourselves to all too many values. Turn your hearts to you again. We confess that we have visited all too many sanctuaries. We have tried to find the sources of life in all too many other places. We have made idols of our occupations, our recreations, and our homes. We turn to you and to you alone to be our God, our only God. Give us spiritual integrity. Give us wholeness and holiness. Answer us, O Lord. Answer us that we be in truth your people. All honor and power be to you, O Christ, forever and ever. Amen. Now hear the gospel's assurance of pardon from Micah chapter 7. Who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity and passing over transgression for the remnant of his inheritance? He does not retain his anger forever, because he delights in steadfast love. He will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. You will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. Seated. Let's join our hearts in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can approach your throne of grace as redeemed sinners who have received the gift of gifts, your Son, who came down to bring us up, who was born like us so that we could become like him, to die our death and shed his satisfying blood for us so that we might have his perfect righteousness. Your plan for our salvation is so much stronger and beautiful than anything we could devise on our own, and yet we are still so quick to imagine that the gospel is no longer necessary for our lives, to depend on our works to make us righteous. We ask, Lord, that you would remind us that we are only sanctified by your Spirit, nothing that we can manufacture on our own. Remind us that it is only by trusting in Jesus that we are washed and made clean by his blood. As we come to hear your word tonight, read and preached to us, we ask that you would sow your word deep into our hearts, that it would bear fruit for us many times over. Fill our hearts with holy affection for your Son, and form our hearts according to your word and according to the image of Jesus Christ. Father, we ask that you be with your servant as he brings your word to us. And may the words of his mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we're going to be reading from Mark chapter 4 tonight. If you're using one of the pew Bibles in front of you, you can find that on page 839. We'll be reading verses 1 through 20. So I invite you to turn there now and read along with me as I read that. Again, that's Mark chapter 4, verses 1 through 20, page 839 on the Pew Bibles. Again, he began to teach beside the sea, and a very large crowd gathered about him, so that he got into a boat and sat in it on the sea, and the whole crowd was beside the sea on the land. And he was teaching them many things in parables. And in his teaching, he said to them, "Listen, "Behold, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seed fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured it. Other seed fell on rocky ground, where it did not have much soil, and immediately it sprang up, since it had no depth of soil. And when the sun rose, it was scorched, and since it had no root, it withered away. Other seed fell among the thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no grain. And other seeds fell into good soil and produced grain, growing up and increasing and yielding 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. And he said, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. And when he was alone, those around him with the 12 asked him about the parables. And he said to them, to you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God, but for those outside, everything is in parables, so that they may indeed see but not perceive, and may indeed hear but not understand, lest they should turn and be forgiven. And he said to them, do you not understand this parable? How then will you understand all the parables? The sower sows the word, and these are the ones along the path where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan immediately comes and takes away the word that is sown in them. And these are the ones sown on rocky ground, the ones who, when they hear the word, immediately receive it with joy. And they have no root in themselves, but endure for a while. Then when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately they fall away. And others are the ones sown among thorns. They are those who hear the word, but the cares of the world, the deceitfulness of riches, and the desires for other things enter in and choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. But those that were sown on the good soil are the ones who hear the word and accept it and bear fruit 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold.
Thank you.
join in prayer. Father, you are our only refuge, our only help in time of trouble, and we know that we have no good apart from you. As we come to our time of offering, we thank you for the inheritance you've given to us through Christ. We ask for your blessing on these offerings now, that they would be used to build your kingdom here and around the world. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen. You may be seated.
Mark chapter 3 and the verses we read together earlier. This incident that's recorded in Mark in this part of his book begins with Jesus on a boat. We've met the boat before. Well, maybe it wasn't the same boat. But the last time we met a boat, Jesus is on the boat as a means of escape, in order to avoid being crushed by the crowds that were making their way around him. Here, however, the boat is a floating pulpit from which he is able to teach the people. You can imagine, for a moment, the crowds sitting along the shore right down to the beach, the gently bobbing boat offshore with Jesus in the posture of a rabbi sitting on the boat and teaching the people. The incident that's recorded here follows a series of interactions between Jesus and the crowds as he teaches them. There are the general masses, we might say, who are generally interested in Jesus, but they're uncommitted. There are the disciples who leave all and follow him. There are the local authorities who are interested in what Jesus says only insofar as they have the opportunity to critique what he has said. And then most recently, we have the theological heavyweights who've come down from Jerusalem and they've come down to pronounce Jesus demon-possessed. All of this we've seen in the build-up to this passage. And all of that variety of interaction with Jesus raises a question in our minds if we've been thinking as we've been reading the story. Why this diversity of response to Jesus? Why so many different ways of reacting to the same person and his teaching? And that's a good question for us to have in our mind, because Jesus is now going to address that question as he summons our attention. Look at verse 3. Listen, he says. Listen. He's speaking to his disciples. You're one of Jesus' disciples, one of his followers this evening. Here is his word to you. First of all, listen. Listen, he says. It's a call to pay attention. And it stands at the beginning of this section, and it's expounded through the section, and then at the end in verse 9, he repeats it and lengthens it. He says, he who has ears to hear, let him hear. So what is Jesus interested in this evening? He wants you to listen to him. He wants you to listen to his teaching. He wants you to be open to his instruction. He wants you to be ready to grasp and understand all that he, the Lord, would say to you as his people. Now, what would be in the minds of the believers as they gathered around Jesus to hear this word that he had called them to attention, to listen to? It would be, why did Jesus get such a mixed reception? And there's a sense in which that question that must have been on their minds and which Jesus is addressing here is a question that must be on our minds. Why does the message about Jesus have such a mixed reception in the world? So whether it was Jesus' day or whether it's our day, the fundamental question is, why does the Christian gospel of the Son of God have such a tough time in getting a hearing and a response, positive response, on the part of men and women in the world? And the answer to the questions lies here. Look at verses 2 and 3. He was teaching them many things in parables, and in his teaching he said to them, listen, behold, a sower went out to sow. Now, in this section that we've read quite a large section this evening, and we'll deal with the whole section, we have the parable stated in verses 3 to 9. We have the parable in principle defined in the central section, and then we have the parable explained in the last section. So let's look at the parable stated, first of all. Jesus is describing something that would have been very familiar to his audience. A sower went out to sow. At this point, the sower is not identified. Nothing is said about the sower, nor about what seed particularly was being sown. It is the principle. It is the picture that is being painted here in broad strokes. And the weight of the parable, that is the point of the parable, the emphasis of the parable, as Jesus states it, lies in the reactions of the people. Or of the soil, rather. Some seed, he says, falls on the well-worn path that runs along the side of the edge of the field. And lying there on the top of that packed soil, the seed does not have the opportunity to germinate. It just lies on the soil. If I put grass seed down on parts of my yard that have become baked hard, they're not going to germinate, they're not going to grow, and the birds will come and will eat the seed. And that's the picture that is painted later on. Some seed falls on the well-worn path and becomes food for the birds. Other seed fell on rocky ground. That is, where there's a basic underlying
rock with a surface of a thin veneer of soil on the surface. The result of it falling is that it takes root. That ground has been churned over. The seed falls into that ground. It has enough water there and room there to start to grow, and it grows quite quickly. But it cannot get its roots down any deeper to sustain its life, and soon it dies. Third category, the seed falls among thorns. Now here the soil is really good. Things grow in this soil. Everything grows in this soil. So the seed immediately puts down its roots, begins to grow, and to grow in quite a lively way. But the plant has competition for light, for space, for nourishment. And so although it grows, it never produces fruit. Now, amongst these three first pictures, one never gets started, one gets started but dies quickly, the third survives but produces no grain. So if the sower sowed to see grain, then in these three different instances, the sower and we who feel some sympathy for him, are disappointed. But there is this fourth soil. Only number four produces fruit. Other seeds fell onto good soil and produced grain, growing up and increasing and yielding 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold. By all accounts and by every measure, there is a harvest. So there you have the parable stated as Jesus told it to the crowds. But let's move on now to verses 10 to 12. Here we have the parable defined. These verses form an interlude. You'll notice that when he was alone, he's alone with the 12 and with some other believers. And they ask him about the parable. That is the principle of the parable. Explain what you're doing in parables, Master, they ask him. And in his answer, Jesus distinguishes between those on the inside and those on the outside. Now, we need to pause here for a moment. There is a biblical background to Jesus' teaching in parables that we miss to our misunderstanding of what is going on here. In Matthew chapter 13, verses 74 to 76, Matthew quotes from Psalm 78, verses 1 and 2. Let me read to you what Matthew writes and his quotation of the psalm. In that section in Matthew 13, it's a similar section to this. Mark is giving us basic details. Matthew gives us much more information about what went on. He was there. Mark wasn't. He was there, and he tells us much more that Jesus said. Here's what Jesus says, according to Matthew 13. Jesus spoke all these things to the crowds in parables. He did not say anything to them without using a parable. So was fulfilled that which was spoken by the prophet, quote, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things hidden since the creation of the world. Close quotes. Quoting from Psalm 78. Now in Psalm 78, the speaker would have been God. God through his servant, the prophet. In Mark 13, we're told it is the Lord Jesus who is the speaker. He is speaking divine things humanly. Through parables, the divine speaker is revealing things hidden since the creation of the world, but he's disguising them. He's hiding them in parables. Now, we shouldn't be surprised by this, because one of the things we've noticed as we've been going through Mark's gospel is that Jesus is regularly hiding himself. He delivers somebody from evil spirits, and he tells the demons not to go around saying what they're saying about him. You're the Holy One of God. You're the Son of God. He tells the demons not to be talking about it. When he heals a man, he says to the man, go and show yourself to the priest, but don't tell them who did this for you. Don't tell them that it was me that did this. Why is he doing that? There is this messianic secret, this hiddenness. Jesus is reserving himself. He doesn't want demons talking about him. He doesn't want some person who's been healed by him talking about him. He has his own agenda, and his own agenda is that he has appointed these 12, and these 12 will be his official spokespeople. They will be the ones to be the apostolic basis for the church. They will be the ones to give us the official Holy Spirit version of the life of Jesus and the teaching of Jesus. And he doesn't want people to misunderstand who he is until after the resurrection that demonstrates who he truly is, as he's raised with power and demonstrated to be the Son of God with power by the resurrection from the dead. There is this hidden aspect, not only in the way in which he tells people not to talk about him, but in the way he teaches the people. He speaks to them in parables. Behind this Greek word, parable, is a Hebrew word which includes a broad range of uses. The Hebrew word, masal, includes a cryptic saying, a proverb. The book of Proverbs is described as in these terms. It can be apocalyptic language, that is, stuff about the end of time, like the book of Revelation, like parts of Ezekiel and Daniel and Isaiah. A similitude, John Bunyan's Pilgrim's Progress, is a similitude, or allegory. In other words, parables are not sermon illustrations. One of the very first books I ever bought out of a Christian bookstore was Donald Gray Barnhouse's book of illustrations, preaching illustrations. And it was from reading that book that I learned how to make up my own illustrations, as I copied his example. So he's to blame if you don't like my illustrations. I'm just trying to reproduce Barnhouse. His methodology, at least. But a parable is not a sermon illustration. Sometimes they're handled as if they are. So we read in verse 11, to you has been given the secret. The Greek word is mysterion, mystery. Has been given the secret of the kingdom of God. But for those outside, everything is in parables. How do we understand this? The secret, the mystery. What is in view is something that remains hidden. What does Psalm 78 say? I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things hidden since the creation of the world. The parable is a cryptic way of containing the germ of something that has been hidden and is now being revealed in a cryptic way in the parable, or in an allegory in the parable. That's what we're being taught here. And the divine mystery has been given, Jesus says, it's been given to you, that is to the apostles, to you. You've been given by God's goodness the secret, the mystery of the kingdom of God. What they were learning in their private meetings with Jesus and in his interpretation of what he was saying publicly to the crowds was they were learning that God's rule, God's kingdom had arrived in the person of God's King, King Jesus. It has arrived in such a way that people could never have imagined it to arrive this way. And it had been given by way of revelation to these apostles that with the arrival of Jesus had come the kingdom of God. Jesus will teach the people in parables, but the apostles, by the Holy Spirit's work, will be enlightened as to the meaning. It had been given to those to understand, while to the rest in parables. Now, interestingly, the word secret or mystery is most used in the Old Testament in one chapter of the Bible in particular, that is the book of Daniel, Daniel chapter 2. It's used 8 times in that one chapter. And you might remember, you probably don't remember, but you should remember, Daniel chapter 2 is one of those memorable bits of the Bible. Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, has a dream. He dreams about an enormous statue, and it's made up of several metals of gold and silver and bronze and iron. And Daniel interprets the dream and says, you know, these are 4 great empires. You, king of Babylon, you're the head of gold. Your empire is probably the most perfect one in terms of the power and authority that you have. It will be diluted as it goes down. But nonetheless, these are the 4 great empires: Babylon, Persia, Greece, Rome. And in the time of the 4th empire, there will be a little pebble released from a hillside to the west. That is towards Jerusalem. And that little pebble will roll down the hill, and as it goes down the hill, it will get bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger until it smashes the kingdoms of the earth. And Daniel gives us this comment at the end of Daniel chapter 2, verse 44. The God of heaven, Daniel says, will set up a kingdom that shall never be destroyed. It shall stand forever. So that's where this word mystery related to the kingdom of God comes from in the Bible. It comes from Daniel chapter 2. And the parables call for faith in the kingdom of God in person. The kingdom of God in person is in Jesus himself. The secret of the kingdom is the person of Jesus. The one who's hiding himself. The one who's speaking in parables. And the effect of the parables upon people depends on their reception of the parables. And so in our text, in that middle section, Jesus quotes from Isaiah chapter 6, to you, that is to the circle of the apostles, has God given by revelation the secret of the kingdom of God, which is me. But to those who are without, everything is obscure, in order that, as it is written, they may, quote, see and yet not see, may hear and yet not understand, unless they turn and God will forgive them. The understanding of who Jesus is requires the opening of our eyes and ears and the illuminating of our minds and hearts. Knowledge of who Jesus is and why Jesus came does not come by human reason, but by divine revelation. And we cannot escape the fact that the secret of the kingdom of God that refers to Jesus is hidden from many still, and that God purposes it to be so. That's why the Apostle Paul can write that a veil hangs over the eyes of the Jewish people as they read their scripture and don't see how their scripture points to Jesus. The secret of the kingdom is that Jesus is God's Messiah, and more importantly, that he is God's Son. God's self-revelation is veiled, we might say hidden, behind Jesus' humanity. So there's a parallel here. I want you to see this parallel. The Son of God, the eternal Son of God, the God who is eternally Son from all eternity, is hidden in his humanity. And the understanding of who he is is hidden by the parable, or in the parable. That's the connection that we're to draw here in our minds. People in the crowd, therefore, did not see him for who he was. His inherent glory would be even more veiled as he hung dying in agony and ignominy on the cross. In the language of Professor Cranfield, he becomes the absolute antithesis of everything that the world understood by divinity and by kingship. The dying Christ, despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, is the very antithesis of divinity and kingship. That's what Cranfield says. And so we find a tension in the Gospels. On the one hand, Jesus revealing himself by doing divine deeds humanly as he displays his power, while on the other hand, we find Jesus veiling himself, using parables, discouraging people talking too much about what he's done, trying to conceal his miracles, and by his telling demoniacs not to tell on him. Why the tension? Because the tension prompts faith, or it exposes unbelief. Because God's plan is that people believe in Jesus. Not simply believe because they see, but that they believe Jesus even when they cannot see. That's the Bible's way. That is God's way of relating to us human creatures, by faith. That's why there's a tension. We walk by faith, not by sight. And there has to be enough tension on the side of credibility to show unbelief to be culpable. So there's credibility in the stories of Jesus, but there's enough tension to demonstrate that the unbelief of the unbeliever is, in fact, a culpable unbelief. It demonstrates how blind and sinful unbelief really is. So the parables are meant to make us think about where we are in relation to Jesus, who is the kingdom of God in person. That's the parable defined. And then the thirdly in the passage, we have the parable unpacked. We said earlier that this word parable includes a number of genres, and allegory is one of them, and there's a certain allegorical element to this. That word masal in Hebrew that I mentioned, behind the Greek word parable, can mean a dark, perplexing saying that's meant to stimulate hard thinking. Therefore, we need interpretation. Jesus tells his disciples that if they don't understand the parable of the sower, they won't understand any of the parables. So we have three parts to the parable, don't we? With the third part being the main one. We have the sower. The sower is unexplained, but surely St. Augustine is right to see the sower going out to sow as the Lord himself, the Lord going out, as it were, from heaven to earth amongst men and women and sowing the seed, and following him, the apostles and the ministers and the evangelists and the missionaries and the Christian witnesses who go out to sow the seed. The seed itself is defined. It is the Word. We can think of the Word when we think of the Bible. We read the Word of God. This is the Word of God. People will refer to preaching as he preached the Word to us. This is the Word used absolutely here. This is an absolute use of the Word. And we can talk about the preaching of the Word about Christ, being sown indiscriminately everywhere. We preach the gospel to everybody, everywhere, as often as we have the opportunity. And we pray as we sow that gospel seed, that it might find a lodging place in the hearts of people. That's why we pray. I hope you pray regularly that as the word of God is preached and as we witness that word one-to-one in our everyday conversations, that that word would find a lodging place in every heart. If you're not praying that, it won't happen, because God's ordained the not only the end, but the means to the end, which is the prayers of the saints. But here the use of the word, in the absolute sense, 8 times, by the way, in this section, is used by Jesus quite intentionally. Because we shall see that the kingdom described is described as coming in seed form. Minuscule, unremarkable. In another parable, Jesus talks about the mustard seed being the smallest of all the seeds. Seeds, these kind of seeds, are despised. And yet they carry in them the whole tree. What does the seed refer to? Next week is Palm Sunday, so I should save this verse till then. But on that first Palm Sunday, in John chapter 12, verse 24, Jesus defines the seed for us. Here's what he says. Here's the fullest meaning of the seed. The seed is the reading of Scripture. The seed is the preaching of the Word of God. But it's more. Jesus says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit." Do you know what he's saying there? He himself is the grain of wheat. His dying, his being planted, dead, buried, will lead to his being raised. And in fact, he goes on to say, that was verse 24 I just quoted, he goes on to say in John 12, verse 32, "And I, when I am lifted up, raised from the earth where I'm buried," lifted up, he says, "I will draw all people to myself." There will be a harvest. There will be fruit. The sower who goes out sowing his seed, crying bitter tears, will come back bearing the sheaves with him, the psalm says. He will bring many, many sons into glory. In other words, the parables speak in a hidden way about the very mystery, not only of who Jesus is, but the mystery of the cross. Not only of Jesus as the Savior and Jesus as the seed, the sower and the seed that falls into the ground and dies and thus bears fruit. And that leads us to the third part, the biggest part, the soils, which represent the human heart or the human person. William Hendrickson, in his commentary, summarizes the four responses of the people to Jesus in this way. First of all, there's the unresponsive heart, verse 15. When the seed falls on that tramped down soil, that hard soil, here are people who are simply indifferent to Jesus. They want nothing to do with him. Nothing gets through to them. Nothing makes an impression upon them. They find everything frivolous about the things of God. Therefore, they are open season for the devil, those people. There were those who enjoyed listening to Jesus, but they were indifferent to him, like the prophet. I remember somebody once gave me this verse. They were referring to some folks who didn't like the the theological position, the evangelical theological position of my preaching and were resisting it. They were of a more liberal theological point of view. This verse in Ezekiel 33, verse 32, "You are to them like a lovely song sung with a beautiful voice and played well on an instrument, for they hear your words but refuse to practice them." And that was Jesus. The unresponsive heart. Then there's the impulsive heart. Both Matthew and Luke use the word "immediately" to describe the response of these second category, verses 16, 17 to Jesus. Initially, it all looks promising. Immediately, they accept the word with joy. And then just as immediately, without any explanation, they fall away. Why? Jesus cites trouble or persecution. Their initial reaction is destabilized by something that happens to them. Business failure, sickness, a tough moral decision, something they learn about Christ and Christianity that rubs them the wrong way, an awkward Christian that they meet, whatever. So they fall away. It's never really taken root. Not in any depth. They fall away because things get rough. Trials come. Trials that were sent to draw them deeper into faith, they become the reason for abandoning the faith. Then thirdly, there's the preoccupied heart. Here the seed takes root, begins to grow, but before it has time to bear fruit, it's choked by other things, and Jesus defines them. The cares of this present world, the deceitful glamour of riches, and the desire for other things. Their minds are distracted by other opportunities and possibilities. The world is full of opinions, desires, pride, prestige, place. Each of these can be a rival for the heart to King Jesus. And then fourth, there's the responsive heart. In one verse, less space than all the others, in one verse, we are reassured there will be a harvest. There will be a harvest. We're also challenged about our own receptiveness to the word of Christ. How am I receiving Christ? How am I receiving Christ in the word that is preached to me? Do I receive it in faith? Do I believe it, in other words? Do I believe Christ in his word, the word of Christ? Do I let it dwell richly within me? Do I receive it in humility, even when it rubs me the wrong way? Do I receive it with humility? Do I receive it the way a cat receives stroking? I don't know if you've got cats. I'm allergic to them. But we did have cats early on in our marriage. And one of the things you'll learn about a cat is if you stroke the cat against the grain, they don't like it. So what do? They get up and they turn around. There was a great American evangelist who used to say to people who complained about him, "You're rubbing us the wrong way," they said. He said to them, "Will you take your example from the cat? If I'm rubbing you the wrong way, get up and turn round." In other words, repent, really, repent. Humbly receiving the word of God. Now, these four swords are interesting to me as I look at the stories in the Gospels. I look at the first group, the unresponsive group. These religious leaders who came down from Jerusalem. There was hatred for Jesus from the beginning. They would not listen to Jesus. I remember Eric Alexander, who used to come and preach at 10, saying at a conference when I was 15 that I heard him at, he used to say this: "There are some people we will not let God speak to us through. We don't like the cut of their jib. We don't like them. We don't, whatever it may be. We will not let God speak to us through that person. And there are some things We will not let God speak to us about some subjects. And it's true. These Pharisees, they've come down and they've made up their mind about Jesus. He's demon-possessed. He's doing his works not by the Holy Spirit, but by the evil spirit. And Jesus says these people cannot, do you remember? They cannot find repentance because they're blaspheming the Holy Spirit. That was the lesson of last week. They fall into this first category. The second category, I think, describes the crowds. Luke much more fully than Mark does, describes the crowds that followed Jesus. They were there for the miracles. They were there for the bread and the fish when he fed the multitude. They were there. Some of them were there, I guess, for the wedding in Cana of Galilee, for the 500 gallons of wine that he got. I found out, by the way, that when John Calvin went to Geneva, part of his salary package was 163 gallons of wine a year. Maybe I should bring this up to the... Now, Jesus makes 500 gallons of wine. Some were along for the wine. They were along for the bread and the fish. They were along for the miracles. And they followed him. And then Jesus gave his little talk one day about taking up your cross and following him. And we're told this, they all deserted him. They deserted him. This comes under that second category. They received it with joy. They were excited. Jesus is in town. Think of that Sunday, Palm Sunday, when they come flooding around him, bearing him into Jerusalem and chanting their hosannas. But where are they when he's arrested and hung on the cross, hung out to dry for our salvation? And then there's the preoccupied heart. Was this Judas? Judas who, for money, sells out the Lord. Was this Demas? Demas, who was a companion to the apostle Paul in his ministry. Very useful man, the apostle Paul says, and yet, the last time we hear about Demas, Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world. And then lastly, those who respond. So the question really, I suppose, this evening is how you and I are doing on these scales. The amount of fruit, by the way, is God's business, not ours. Just as the amount of fruit we have as churches is not our business, but God's. The business of the church is to sow the seed. God does the watering, and God makes things grow. One sows, one waters. God makes the seed grow. How do you receive the word of God? How are you receiving the Lord Jesus? Is he yours? Do you follow him? Do you love him? Do you serve him? Are you one of these people who's, even as you sit today, you're just hard to him? Or you're a Christian for the good days, but when things get rough, you're going to bail? Or maybe like Demas or Judas, something better will come along. And you'll get so fascinated with it that you'll lose sight of Jesus. We need to examine our hearts, don't we? We need to pray that God would take his word and particularly take the Christ of the word, that he might dwell in our hearts by faith. Lord Jesus, we pray today that we would learn that the secret of the kingdom is none other than you yourself as our King. You who came to be hidden in human form. You who hid the truth about yourself in the parables, dressed them up in very ordinary language and ordinary stories, to be unpacked, to be blown open when, after having, like the seed, died and been buried, you rose again, and today you are producing fruit in the lives of men and women, boys and girls, all across the world. We pray that you would continue to work in us. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Now may the blessing of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you now and evermore. Amen.